بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده. Dear respected viewers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to another brand new episode of the program entitled Towards the Origin, broadcasted live from the studio of Channel S, watched on Sky 814. And to all of those who will also be joining us through our website, that is Channel S website live streaming, and through our social media platform, whether it be through Facebook page or YouTube channel. Inshallah, it is a live interactive program where we discuss different topics every week. And our tonight's topic for discussion is consuming halal. It's one of the most important obligations upon us as Muslim to earn, consume what is pure and halal that has been provided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sustenance. Now, as Muslims, how much do we understand the term halal? Is halal limited to only consuming food, or halal also means in the whole life that we maintain, that we lead, all of this needs to be around what is halal? All of this and many more, inshallah, we'll be discussing in our tonight's program. And to discuss this topic, we have with us a graduate from Al-Azhar University. He is the Imam and the Khateeb of the famously known mosque, whether it is London Central Mosque and Islamic Cultural Centre, famously known as Regent Park's Mosque. In fact, he's the first British Bangladeshi origin who is the Imam and Khateeb of this famously known mosque, Regent Park Mosque. Fadilatul Shaykh Kazi Lutfur Rahman. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
First of all, to start with, thank you very much for joining with us again so late at night.
Barakallahu feekum. It's my pleasure.
Now, we know it's our first Jummah in the month of Shaban, and yes. Ramadan is not too far away.
That is true.
And I think our homework needs to start from now, yes, rather than starting from
preparation,
Ramadan.
Plans and...
And the other thing, as you've rightly mentioned, preparation and plan. And I think if we don't plan, there's a saying, we plan to fail.
That's true.
Now, to start with, the Muslim community as in general, when it comes to halal, we have our understanding, or we restrict it to only food. Mm-hmm. There are halals, earning, halal, a lot of other factors that contribute and consist, and things needs to be taken into consideration, whether those areas are halal or not. We do not consider that. We only restrict ourselves to food. Now, I would like to start with this question. What is the actual definition of halal?
Jazakumullah khairan. Alhamdulillahi jalla jalaluhu. والمصلى عليه محمد وآله اللهم ارزقنا بنور الفهم وأخرجنا من الظلمات الوهم وانشر علينا من خزائن علمك ورحمتك اللهم ارزقنا فهم النبيين وحفظ المرسلين وإلهام الملائكة المقربين أن تجعل لساننا عامرا بذكرك وقلوبنا بخشيتك وأسرارنا بطاعتك وأنت حسبنا ونعم الوكيل. After praising Allah and sending salam and salutations to our beloved Prophet Muhammad salawatu rabbi wa salamuhu alayh, I testify that there is none worthy of worship except Allah. He is one and he has no partners. And I also testify that the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the final messenger and slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, before I continue with this discussion of consuming halal, first of all, I would like to say that I'm a preacher and at the same time, I'm a listener as well. So the audience would definitely include me because I'm in more need of nasiha than anybody else.
Every one of us.
Every one of us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Remind. Perhaps reminder can benefit the believers, and I'm not better than anybody here. And also, I would like to make an advance apology today if I would offend anybody or if I would make anyone upset. So I'd like to make an advance apology. I hope, inshallah, everyone will overlook any mistakes or any kind of comments which may upset anybody. Now, coming to the discussion of halal, it is one of the most well-known, common, important things a Muslim starting from a child, a Muslim of any age or any place or any era will understand the word halal. Very famous, very well-known. And fortunately, many non-Muslims today, they also are aware of the issue of halal. And we have seen in many goods, like many products, such as breads and
consumer products,
we see that it's written halal or authorized by halal authority or halal organizations.
But having said that, we also know in a lot of recent articles and newspapers, we have seen people are misleading,
yes.
Especially Muslims are misleading other Muslims in saying that either this particular meat or the particular product is halal, and then it turns out to be
this is fraud. Yeah, I mean, that's again, this is a separate discussion, and Muslims are a nation who must be absolutely completely away from any kind of lie or cheating or any fraud and scandal, and unfortunately we see some people that are doing it, and that's something that we have to be very careful. Now, when we come to the word halal, it comes from a noun, masdar, halla yahillu. It comes from a noun, halla yahillu. So it's a hadha halal, ma ahallahu Allah. So this is halal, and it has been permitted by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, which means it's permissible generally, allowed. And who allows it or who permits it? It's allowed or permitted by the Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He created us. He owns us. He's our owner. And He knows what is good for us and what is bad for us. What is pure and beneficial for us and what is harmful and what can cause problems for our bodies, for ourselves. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows exactly what is good for us and what is bad for us. So therefore, when He created us, He didn't leave us without any instruction, without any guidelines. Rather, He gave, He sent in uncountable or many prophets and messengers in order to guide us. So when we say halal, means permitted by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. When we say haram, prohibited by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, the Creator Himself.
Now, the concept of halal and haram, now I just wanted to get a certain clarification. Things that are directly mentioned haram, we understand that's prohibited.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the opposite or the other side of it, things that are not directly mentioned as prohibition,
as haram. Mm-hmm.
But not even given any confirmation whether it's halal either.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how does one dwell within this situation? Because we know in 21st century we live in.
I'll just come to read a hadith which will clarify, which will make this question, inshallah, clear, or which will answer this question just in a while. But before I go to that hadith, I would like to recite a verse from the Holy Quran. Generally, what Allah the Almighty says about consuming, or taking, or intaking the halal or permissible things to our body, to our life, to our family. So Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nisa in verse 29. So He says, A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu la ta'kulu amwalakum baynakum bil batil. لا تأكلوا أموالكم بينكم بالباطل إلا أن تكون تجارة عن تراض منكم ولا تقتلوا أنفسكم إن الله كان بكم رحيما. So Allah تبارك وتعالى says in this verse, all you who believe, all believers, لا تأكلوا أموالكم بينكم بالباطل. Do not eat the property of one another. Do not consume. لا تأكلوا. Do not eat أموالكم, the wealth of others, or wealth of one another, بالباطل, unjustly. Do not take or consume, or do not consume the property or the wealth of others unjustly. بالباطل. إلا أن تكون تجارة, except it is through the permissible or lawful business, تجارة, which has been permitted in Islam. تجارة, عن تراض منكم, and except what is through the mutual agreements, what is through the agreements of two. So do not take anything unjustly or consume or eat unjustly, generally speaking, whether it's earning or it's food or it's even it could be knowledge. You know, sometimes people, we see that people steal the knowledge. Someone may write an article, or sometimes someone may write a book, then you see somebody else just copied it.
So plagiarism.
Yeah. Mm. So people may take things or snatch away things of others without a lawful mean.
So that means it's not only restricting ourselves to food, but in all aspects of mu'amalat.
In every aspect of dealing in transaction, mu'amala, and public relation. So illa an takuna tijara, only we are allowed to consume and take through the halal or lawful business and mutual agreements. Now, if you give me something, if you give me a small pen, or if you give me a mobile, for example, and you're happy with it, then there's no problem. So the word taradi, very important, the mutual agreements or understanding of both the giver and the taker.
Now, there is a slight misunderstanding here within the community, especially I think within the Muslim community, that when we try to do any sort of business or tijara, that we do it in complete trust. Good, we should have trust. But when it comes to even whether it be our close family or relatives, we tend not to do any sort of legal agreement or witnesses. Yes. And this then we see leads into a lot of issues.
I mean, sometimes I normally say that as Muslims, we have too much trust. Excessive trust, and sometimes excessive trust can also lead to problems. And therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا تَدَايَنْتُمْ بِدَيْنٍ إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ مُسَمًّا فَاكْتُبُوا. He says that if you take debt of someone, or if you give debt to somebody, then write it down, make a record. Even it may be your own family members. This is sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
Very, very important.
Very important, because human beings, we are forgetful. It's not that I may not lie, but what might happen that I may forget.
Or someone passes away.
Or maybe misunderstandings can take place. A lot of problems, a number of problems are rooted to the misunderstanding and also maybe forgetfulness. Someone maybe said something or made an agreement, but he said, I didn't say it. But he actually forgot, but he doesn't mean to, or maybe intend to lie.
Or even the other aspect is maybe they might have said in a context that might have been understood in a different
Absolutely
context.
Absolutely correct. So therefore, writing is important, and it's sunnah of Rasulullah, and it's an instruction in the Holy Quran that when you make, and it's not offensive, but it's not bad. Like sometimes we take it we take it as an offense, but it is not offensive because this saves a lot of problems in the future.
When you say take it as offense, it's like people that we are relative, we're related, and we've been knowing each other for so long, and yet he's asking me to get into a contract.
Yes.
Okay.
But Islam makes put everything in perspective, and as I said, Islam also...
Balanced.
Masalih. Whatever we see in Islam is masalih, is the benefits of the people. It's for the benefits of the people. So, أن تكون تجارة عن طرد. So, through the mutual agreements. And then he says, وَلَا تَقْتُلُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ. Do not kill yourselves. Do not kill one another. Do not kill yourself. إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ بِكُمْ رَحِيمًا. And surely Allah is most merciful to you. Now, when we also talk about the word halal, we find a similar word of halal or for halal in Arabic or in the Holy Quran considered as الطيبات. So, halal literally means tayyibat, pure things, good things. What is beneficial for us, healthy for us? And again, on the other side, or on the other hand, when we look at the word haram, it may mean something that is harmful and something can cause harms for ourselves and for our bodies. So after giving the definition of the word halal and haram, I would like to mention a verse from the Holy Quran which describes the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Injil and in Torah, in Torah and in Gospel and Bible. So the verse goes like in Surah Al-A'raf, in verse 157, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, النبي الأمي الذي يجدونه مكتوبا عندهم في التوراة والإنجيل that الذين يتبعون الرسول النبي. So the verse goes, الذين يتبعون الرسول النبي الأمي. Those who will follow the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. يتبعون الرسول النبي الأمي, the one who didn't know how to read and write. Now, some of us, we might think, oh, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam didn't know how to read and write, and this might be a dishonor for him. But in fact, not knowing how to read and write gives an honor to the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because his teacher was Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala himself directly, and his the means of his knowledge was revelation, al-wahi. And even some of the scholars, they say that there was nobody here in this world who would have the credential to teach this great individual, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Very true. And the other aspect, if I see it from the other side, if he was highly educated and then conveying the message of Islam,
the people say he made himself.
Na'udhu billahi min dhali, yes. Because of his education.
Yes, you know, he could be. And the people said, the enemies of Islam in Mecca and other places, they said that he was a poet and he was this, he was...
Even today, made of things, some sort of allegations.
But someone who never been in any university or in college or school gives a very clear understanding to the humanity that this, whatever he said, he preached from his Lord.
Has to be a revelation.
Subhanahu wa ta'ala, yes. So, الَّذِينَ يَتَّبِعُونَ الرَّسُولَ النَّبِيَّ الْأُمِّي. Those who will follow this prophet who was an ummi who didn't know how to read and write. يَجِدُونَهُ مَكْتُوبًا عِنْدُهُمْ فِي التَّوْرَاةِ وَالْإِنْجِيلِ. They will find it has been written in Injil and Torah, in Gospel and in Torah. يَأْمُرُهُمْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. He enjoins what is right. He tells people to do what is good. يَأْمُرُهُمْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. Whatever is good in terms of aqidah, the oneness of Allah, the monotheism, in terms of good things, righteous deeds, ta'awun. يَأْمُرُهُمْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. He tells others what to do or others to do good things. وَيَنْهَاهُمْ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. And he prohibits and he prevents others from doing bad things. وَيَنْهَاهُمْ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. Enjoin what is right and forbid what is evil. وَيُحِلُّ لَهُمُ الطَّيِّبَاتِ. And he makes the pure good things lawful for him. يُحِلْ. He makes good things halal for him. So you can easily understand the word halal was described or it was explained as طيبات. Generally, it's something that is beneficial and good.
And whenever Allah mentions in the glorious Quran halal, we always find there's the word طيب associated with
exactly,
halal.
Exactly, yes, absolutely right. So, يَأْمُرُهُمْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَاهُمْ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَيُحِلُّ لَهُمُ الطَّيِّبَاتِ. He makes good things lawful for him. وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْخَبَائِثِ. And he make bad things, الْخَبَائِثِ, you know, the word خُبْث, خَبَائِثِ is the plural of خُبْث. The bad things, something that can be harmful, socially, individually, generally harmful, it has been made haram or unlawful in the religion.
Now, some people in our culture, the terms khaba'is is directly mentioned in the Quran.
Yeah.
But culturally, we might understand something different.
Yes, yes.
Now, what is the definition according to the Quran, the term khaba'is? Is it just what is impure?
So something that's bad or something that can be harmful, something that can be unpleasant, impure, all those things can go under the word al-khaba'is. وَيُحَرِّمُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْخَبَائِثِ. And then Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala says in Surah Taha, in verse 81, he says, كُلُوا مِن طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ. Eat from the طَيِّبَات, from the pure things. طَيِّب, the many of us, we know the word طَيِّب. So طَيِّبَات, the plural of طَيِّب. So eat from the pure things, pleasant, good, beneficial things. كُلُوا مِن طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ. From what I gave you as sustenance, rizq. مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ. وَلَا تَطْغَوْ فِيهِ. And do not transgress. Do not cross the bounds, the limits. طغيان is a very bad and very severe sin. And Allah Tabaraka doesn't like the طاغين, those who commit the طغيان, transgression, those who cross or go beyond the red lights.
So when you say transgression, is it only restricting towards the halal or in every matter of ibadat
yes,
as well?
Yes, in every matter of ibadat, yes, generally in our religion. So, وَلَا تَطْغَوْ فِيهِ. And here mainly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about the food consumption because the context is the food. كُلُوا مِن طَيِّبَاتِ مَا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ وَلَا تَطْغَوْ. And do not transgress the bounds and the limits of Allah تبارك وتعالى. فَيَحِلَّ عَلَيْكُمْ غَضَبِي. And if you do so, then Allah's wrath and anger will occur. Allah will be angry and his wrath will come down and that will envelop everyone, every individual of the society. And are we not seeing the reality? Now you see the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there. We see the difficult situation that as an ummah we're going through, as Muslim ummah nation, all over the world. Yes, there are many, many reasons we can find, analyze, and we can come up with so many different explanations. But part of the explanation, or one of the primary things, is that we are committing a lot of sins as well. I mean, as Muslims, we have actually abandoned and we came quite far from our religion, generally we're saying. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said in Surah Ar-Ra'd very clearly, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يُغَيِّرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. Allah doesn't distort or change the fate of a nation unless they've done something by themselves.
Now, many people would say, well, most of us, we pray five times a day, we follow the pillars of Islam, we give our zakah, sadqah, whatever it is.
So you see, the five pillars of Islam are considered as primary or fundamental issues of the religion, but they're not everything in the religion. So therefore, Prophet ﷺ said, "Buni al-Islamu ala khamsin." Islam, the building of Islam, pillar, has been built upon five important pillars. But if you just have a house and some pillars, is that complete? Is that enough? So no. We have to have the completeness of the religion. Udkhulu fi silmi kaffa, enter into the fold of religion completely and fully. So, fayahilla alaykum ghadabi, and we can see the ghadab of Allah, the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there. And we are facing tremendous difficulties and we're suffering in many different ways in the Muslim world, in all over the world, because there are, unfortunately, there are a lot of sins. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help me, everyone, the whole community, and give us the ability to stay away from things which can cause the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even when we talk about the famine, when we talk about al-kusuf, al-khusuf, you know, the things that happen with the sun, the kusuf, when the sun loses light, mm-hmm. Just remind me the word.
Eclipse.
Eclipse, for example, yeah. Yes, solar eclipse and lunar eclipse.
Yeah.
Kusuf, al-khusuf, known as in Arabic. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam considered them as ayah min ayatillah. These are signs of Allah in order to remind the people about certain things that they have committed. In hadith is mentioned, because the Arabs used to think that the kusuf al-khusuf eclipse happens due to the death of a great individual or due to the birth of someone, a baby in a high status family. But Prophet ﷺ, he removed that misunderstanding and he said, no, it doesn't happen because of anyone's death or birth, but it happens because to remind the most people of the world, look at the famine, look at the drought, look at the tornado, look at the floods that take place all over the world. And we can see that wrath of Allah.
You mean the natural calamities that
natural
take place.
Natural calamities, indeed. But we heard recently that it's sad that the world is going through the toughest time in terms of humanitarian crisis. And subhanAllah, this world meant to be the most advanced world. We're living in a world which is considered to be the most advanced in every ways, in terms of knowledge, technology, you name it.
We've advanced so much. But then again, we might argue, even science does tell us the explanation why these things happen. We have that scientific knowledge and fact in one place. But at the same time, we have the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the other side as well.
Yes, 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 definitely, indeed. Now, you have mentioned earlier that is everything halal and haram in Islam? I have found people actually in our... Do you want to say something?
No.
Yeah. We found people that who have the tendency of saying everything is halal. So this is okay. This is allowed. I mean, Allah is kind. Allah is merciful. It's okay. Just do it.
I mean, we'll leave it there, inshallah.
Okay, no problem.
I know, because it's time
it's
for a short commercial break. So I want to hear it fully when we come back after the break, inshallah. My dear viewers, it's time for a short commercial break. You have been listening to our tonight's topic for discussion, which is consuming halal. Our Sheikh, respected Sheikh, has been explaining the definition of halal, the importance of tayyib, the pure, and how should we deal with it in our day-to-day life. We'll continue our discussion, inshallah, after the break. Do stay tuned with us. We'll be right back in a few moments. You're watching Towards the Origin. Wassalamu alaikum.